Dear students, so I am recording the second lesson about probabilistic forecasting. More particularly, it is an introduction to probabilistic forecasting, as I cannot give you the lesson in life for a personal matter. So I am recording the lesson, and I will organize a session and a question answer at another time. To answer your questions about this second lesson and about the forecasting assignment. So, but for this recording video, this is just about the second lesson, introduction to probabilistic forecasting. So the learning objectives of this lecture are first to learn to produce probabilistic forecasts and to perform verification of probabilistic forecasts. So in the previous lesson, we have seen point forecasts. And in fact, we have seen the similar manner that was to compute point forecast and to perform verification of point forecast. And in this lesson, we will see how to compute probabilistic forecast and to perform probabilistic forecast, verification of probabilistic forecast, sorry. So first of all, a little reminder about forecasting, in fact. So forecasting is a tool for decision making. It is a natural step to decision making. And so we use some key parameters for a microgrid to perform some forecast. For instance, we would like to forecast PV or wind power generations or hydraulic power generation, etc. If we have some generation into our microgrids, if we have some loads, for instance, office, industrial resilience, etc., maybe we would like to perform some forecast also of these quantities. But it can be also about electricity prices or gas prices, etc. So you consider your microgrid, you make a list of the items that are composing this microgrid, and you try to assess for each item you would like to perform some forecast to help to make decisions. Little reminder about point forecast, about the point forecast definitions that we have seen in the previous lesson. So a forecast is an estimate that is computed at time t. For time t plus k. So we are at time t and we gather some information, some information about our process. And based on this information up to time t, we are trying to make an estimate of what will happen in the future, for instance, at time t plus k. K is his name is called the forecasting horizon. And the point forecast informs of the conditional expectation of power generations. So if you consider power generation, so for instance, wind power generation or PV power generation, it is a stochastic process because it depends on a certain number of variables. So for instance, the weather, but it could be something else. And these quantities are stochastic. They are random variables. And the point forecast is, in fact, the expectation of the stochastic process, sorry, based on some conditional informations that we have gathered up to time t. So this is why we are talking about conditional expectation, because the expectation is conditioned to something, the information that we gather up to time t. This is why point forecast is an expectation of the random process here that is noted bi with some information. So given the information set big omega, a model g, and its estimated parameter at time t. And the model G can be anything. It can be a machine learning model, it can be a parametric model, etc. In the previous lesson, we have also seen how to use a strategy to assess forecast. And we have seen two strategies. The first one was to split the data set into a learning and a validation set. But we have only one pair. That is composed of the training and the validation set. You use the training set to estimate the parameter of your forecasting model. Then once your model is trained, once you have estimated its parameter, you use this model to perform forecast on the validation set, and you compute some metrics to assess the model. You have a second strategy that is named K-cross-validation. In this strategy, you consider the same dataset, but you divide this dataset into k pairs of random learning and validation sets. And here on this figure, on the right part, this is, for instance, one pair of validation set and training set. In red, it is the validation set, and in green, the training set. And so this is one random realization. You train your model on your learning set, and you assess it on the validation set. You compute your score, okay? Then you compute a second random pair of learning and validation set. And so the validation set will be another part of the data set, et cetera, et cetera. So you do it 10 times. So you will have 10 different scores for 10 different validation sets, because you would have estimated your parameters on 10 different learning sets, but so you would have 10 different parameters of your model, and you make the average of the scores. And so this is another strategy that is named K-cross-validation. Okay. And we have seen also how to use some quantitative metrics to assess the point forecast. So for instance, the first one is a bias, to estimate the bias. And the bias, in fact, is the average of the error. The error of a point forecast is the true realizations of your process. So for instance, the PV generation, but the true observation of the PV generation at the time t plus k, minus the forecast. And you make the average over all the forecasting time periods. This is called the bias. If your bias is zero, it means that in fact, sorry for Slack, it means that in fact your model has no bias. But you have also the mean absolute error, that is the average of the absolute of the error. And so you can compute the mean absolute error like this, and you can have a normalized versions by dividing the score by something else. So for instance, for PV generations or wind power generations, often people, they normalize the score by dividing the score by the total installed capacity. So for instance, for a PV plant with an installed capacity of 100 kilowatts, you have your score. So imagine, for instance, you compute your mean absolute error and you have a mean absolute error of 50 kilowatts. So it means that on average, you have an error of 50 kilowatts. You can divide it, this 50 kilowatt by 100, and it will do 0.5. It means 50% error in terms of the total installed capacity. And it is quite practical, in fact, to use the normalized version, because if you say, for instance, oh, okay, I have an error with my forecasting model, I have a mean absolute error of 150 kilowatts. Oh, me, I have 250, okay? But we don't know, in fact, what is this error in comparison with the total installed capacity of the plant. So if you say, for instance, yeah, in fact, I have an error of 50% of my total installed capacity, it means something, because we can represent this error more easily than just if it is 50 kilowatt, okay, but is it a lot or is it, no, we don't know really. So that's why most of the time we use normalized versions of this matrix, because it's easier to understand when we are talking about an error of 50%, 20%, 30%, 100% of the total installed capacity. And the third one is the root mean square error. That is the average of the root square. And for the normalized version, you divide this score by the total installed capacity. Okay, that was a reminder. Concerning the probabilistic forecasting. So in fact, there are various types of probabilistic forecasting. And a lot of this methodology are used for practical case study. And they range from quantile to density forecast, but also prediction intervals, scenario, etc. So we will see what is it. But so we are at time t. We have gathered some information, some knowledge of our stochastic process. So let's say, for instance, that we are considering a PV generation plan. So we have, for instance, information about the weather, so the solar irradiation or the air temperature. The clouds, etc. We know the location of the plant. We know the maintenance planning for the week ahead, etc. So we have gathered this information up to time t, and we would like to predict what will be the PV generation at time t plus k. Okay, will it be higher or smaller than what we have right now? Let's begin with the quantile forecast. A quantile forecast is to be seen as a probabilistic threshold for power generation. So if you take the figure here on this slide, you have the observations, you have the point forecast that is the conditional expectation of the random process, and you have also the quantile forecast, and more precisely, you have here the quantile 50%. So what does it mean? The quantile 50% means that if you follow these points, you have above these points 50% of probability, so 0.5, the probability of 0.5, that your actual observations, so here's the power, will be higher than this value. And you have also a probability of 0.5 that your actual realization of this random process will be below this value. So this is different than the point forecast. The point forecast is a kind of an average. It is an expectations. So it means that for this random process, we think on average, based on the information that we have gathered up to time t, that we will have on average this amount of generation. The quantile forecast, this is not that. It is in terms of probability. We have a curve, and above the curve for the quantile 50%, we have a probability of 0.5 of having more generation, and a probability of 0.5 of having less generation. This is quantile forecast. And so, you define your quantile. In fact, you have to define your quantile. So for instance, you could say, okay, I would like to forecast the quantile 50%, but if you are interested in this quantile 50%, but maybe you will be interested in the quantile 30%, 10%, 90%. So Q is a normal level. It is a quantile. So you have your information set. This can be weather forecast, past observation, etc. You have a model J. You try to estimate the parameter of your model. And based on that, you try to produce some quantile forecast. One way of producing quantile forecast is to use the cumulative distribution functions of your random process. But of course, you don't know this cumulative distribution function. So you have to find a way to estimate this cumulative distribution function, because if you know it, a quantile is just the inverse of this cumulative distribution function. So if you knew, if you, by any means, you succeed to estimate this cumulative distribution function, you take the inverse and you can compute your quantile forecast for a given quantile Q. So this is one way of doing it, but there are many other ways. Then we have also another kind of probability forecast that is named prediction interval. A prediction interval is an interval within which power generation may lie within a certain probability. And you can use quantile forecasts to build this prediction interval. So for instance, here on the figure, you have a kind of gray area, okay? So the black curve is a point forecast, so it is the conditional expectations. This is what you expect on average to have. You have some points that are the observations, and so you have this gray area. This is a 90% prediction interval. What does it mean? It means that you expect 90% of the observation will be in this interval. Okay? And here, if you have a look at it, it is not so bad, because most of the time the observation is within this interval. Okay? So you can define your prediction interval with quantile, because here, look at this prediction interval. You have an upper and a lower part. So here, for instance, the upper part of this prediction interval could be quantile 80%, and the upper part could be quantile 10%. Because if you have the quantile 10%, it means that 90% of the observation should be above, And if you have the quantity 80%, it means that 80% of the observation should be below. So it means that on average, you will have 80% probability of 0.8 to be in this interval. Okay. Sorry, I just told you quantile 80%. It is quantile 90% for the upper part, not quantile 80%. So I repeat myself. For this prediction interval, you could have the upper part of the gray area that is quantile 90%, and the quantile 10% for the lower part. Okay. So this is one way, but there are other ways of building prediction interval. We have also what is called predictive density definitions, and the predictive density fully describes probabilistic distributions of power generation for every lead time. So it means that, in fact, this technique tries directly to estimate the cumulative distribution function, because if you know it, you can in fact sample every quantile that you want. So here it is what we have on this figure. You still have the point forecast and the observations, and you have different levels of colors that represent several prediction intervals that are computed by using the cumulative distribution functions. And so with this technique, you directly estimate the density, so the cumulative density distribution function, so you can compute whatever you want. And last but not least, we have the another technique that is named scenario or trajectories. And in fact, with this technique, trajectories are equally likely samples of multivariate predictive density for power generation in time or space. So here we still have the observations, we still have the point forecast, and here you can see several scenario or trajectories. Okay, you have several, and each one of them represent a possible realization of the random process. And with this technique, you are trying to sample at time t several trajectories. And then you can use these several samples to make decision making. So let's take an example. And this example is about quantile forecast. And a quantile forecast of PV generation. So we have two plots. On the left part, it is a quantile forecast of PV generations that has been computed by using a neural network, a feed-forward neural network. And on the right part, we have also quantile forecast of PV generations that was computed using a recurrent neural network. And in this case, it is a long short-term memory neural network. But you don't have really to care about this kind of neural network. It is just to show you that by using two different models. So here we have two different models. On the left part, it is a model based on a feed-forward neural network. And the right part, it is a model based on a long short-term memory neural network. You have two different results because these models are different, so they have different parameters to estimate, etc. And these models have their own pros and cons, but it's just to show you that with two different models, you have two different quantile forecasts. And so in red, it is the observation, PM. So you have the realizations of the PV generation for this day. And in black, you have the point forecast using this model, and in blue with the you have the extreme quantiles. So Q1 is a 10% quantile and QQ is the 90% quantile. So that means that we are expecting that the realizations of the PV generations will lie between these two quantiles with a probability of 0.8. So between the 10% quantile and the 90% quantile. So if the models are well estimated and if we have performed to well capture the random process, this is what we should expect. And if we have a look, you can see that the quantile forecasts do not have the same shape between these two models. And the model of the right, the long short-term memory network, you can see that these two extreme contacts, the 10% and 90%, they are more distant between each other than with the model of the on the left part. But it does not mean that the model on the right part is better than the model on the left part, because one could expect to have narrow prediction interval, because if you have narrow prediction interval, you can say, okay, I am very confident that my observation will be between these two contacts, but maybe it depends of your random process. Maybe you have a random process that cannot have very narrow prediction interval for a given day. So you cannot just assess the model on visual inspection. You have to compute some metrics. But the visual inspection may provide you some insight of the random process. And so, of course, we expect that extreme contacts, for instance, the 10%, 90%, will, in a sense, follow the shape of the PV generation, because imagine you have a 10% contact that is doing that is big at the beginning of the day. For instance, it is strange because at the beginning of the day you have a low power generation in terms of PV. So visual inspection helps you to assess if your model is doing right in a certain way, but you cannot just rely on PV on a visual inspection. You need to perform some quantile metrics in this case. So that's why we need to understand how to make verification of probabilistic forecasts. So let's take the case study that is the PV parking rooftops of Liège University. So it is a PV installations of 460.4 kilowatt. And so we have the data because the PV generation is monitored here at Liège University. And for this case study, the forecasting model J is a feed-forward neural network. We consider only one hidden layer. The inputs of the model are the weather forecast of solar irradiation and air temperature. The output layer of this model is composed of 96 neurons because we would like to compute the forecast of each quarter of the next day. So imagine we are at day minus one. So we are day minus one at 2 PA. And we would like to compute the prediction of the PV generation for the next day. And we have discretized the time of the next day in 96 quarters. We could have discretized it in 24 hours, but here we decided to have a thinner time resolutions by computing 96 values instead of 24. That's why we have here 96 neurons, one per time steps. And it is implemented in Python using the TensorFlow library. So let's remember about how to assess the forecast. And so you have several strategies. So for instance, splitting the data set into a learning and a validation set, but you can also use a K cross-validation strategy by computing K pairs of random learning and validation sets. Okay. But one thing to remember is that if you want to assess your model, you need to verify forecasts and data that has not been used for the modeling. So if you use your training set as a validation set, there will be a problem because you have estimated the parameters of your model on the training set. And if you make a prediction on this training set and you use this prediction to assess your model, okay, maybe you will have very nice metrics because you will see that it fits well, but maybe if then you use your model to predict future events on your data, maybe your model will not perform well because you need to verify your forecasts on data that has not been seen to avoid what is named overfitting. So when you have a model you have some parameters to estimate. So you have to learn the parameter of your models. So you use a training set to learn the parameter. And it takes a certain amount of time to train this model. And so you can spend a lot of time or not a lot of time to train your parameter. So you have to find a trade-off, in fact, in terms of learning. But if you learn too much, if you learn a lot, so you focus on your training set, you take this model and you learn, you make learn this model, probably it will learn very well on this training set. So you will have very nice results on this training set, but you may have some overfitting. So you will be completely dependent on this data. And then when you will use other data, new data to predict future events, maybe your model will not be able at all to make a good predictions. So we would like to avoid overfitting. So that's why we use two data sets, a training set and a validation set. And the validation part is a part where the data have not been used by the model to learn its parameters. And this is the same principle for K-cross validation, because you have a learning and a validation set. So as I already said, first, the easiest thing to do is visual inspections. And it is good to do visual inspection because it allows you to develop substantial insight on forecast quality. So just plot your forecast. This is a good advice, plot your forecast first before computing any metrics, because maybe you make a small error in code and maybe you have something strange, but it does not provide you an error, but you will have a plot of something strange. And just by a visual inspection, you will see, okay, I probably made something wrong because there is something very strange in the plot. So the first thing is just plot your forecast, have a look at it, just to see if they have a shape, a kind of shape that you are expecting. Because, for instance, for PV generation, you expect to have a specific shape because you know the process, you know the shape of PV generation. If it is a sunny day, you expect a nice bell production curve. If it is a very cloudy day, you expect a kind of very flat, very small production curve. And if it is a day where sometimes you have clouds and sometimes sun, it will be a kind of a curve with some spikes of production. So for instance, so most of the time when we are performing forecasting, we know in a sense the stochastic process. We know how it looks like. We know the shape of what we want to forecast. So use this knowledge. When you are doing forecasting to try to assess if your model is doing something wrong. So first thing to do, visual inspection. And here, for instance, so we have our two neural networks, so two different kinds of neural networks. So there are two different kinds of model. And on the left part, we have the MLP and the right part LSTM, so long short-term memory. So what do you think of these two? Are they good or are they bad? What we can say just by having a look at it just like that is that, we have in red the observations. So we can see that the observations, sometimes it produce a lot and sometimes it produce less. So it means that we have a cloud, but the shape is on average a kind of bell. So, okay. And so we can see that the models, the quantiles of these two models, they kind of follow this shape. So in a sense, it is okay. So we could say with the visual inspection, okay, even if the quantiles of these two models are different, because you can see that they don't have the same shape, they follow, in a sense, the bell curve. And also, the extreme quantile, the lower extreme quantile, that is a 10% quantile, and the upper extreme quantile, that is a 90% quantile, we can see that most of the time, the PV observation, that is here in red, lies within these two extreme quantiles, even if it's a little bit different between the two models. But on average, we can see that it is okay. So we could say, okay, because between these two quantiles, we have a probability of 0.8 that the SGO perversion should be within this prediction interval. So in a sense, it seems not so bad, okay? But then it is very difficult at this stage to conclude which model is the best. Because here, okay, even if they have the same shape, the quantiles are not the same. And so we need now to compute some probabilistic metrics to conclude. But the visual inspection here say, okay, this model seems okay. We cannot conclude, but they seem okay. So the thing about probabilistic forecast is that it's a little bit harder to assess with quantitative metrics than with a point forecast. So the question to ask is, how do you want your forecast? Do you want your forecast to be reliable? So that is also referred to as probabilistic calibration. Or do you want your forecast to be sharp? Or do you want your forecast to be skilled? So depending on the question, you have different answer, and so you have different probabilistic metrics. So you can combine a lot of metrics to make a kind of mix, or depending on what you want to achieve to perform with your forecast, you will target a more a specific metric. But it is always the same thing when you have a model, you want to do something with your model, in fact. And so you try to improve your model with respect to this application. So you will use some metric in relation with your application. So let's first consider reliability. That is also named probabilistic calibration. Calibration is about respecting the probabilistic contract. So for instance, if you consider quantile forecast with a nominal level Q that is 0.5, so in other words, the quantile 50%, one expects that the observations are to be less than the forecast 50% of the time. Because this is what you expect. If you have a good quantile forecast, 50% of the time your observation will be higher and 50% the observation will be lower. If you consider prediction interval with a numerical coverage of 90%, one expects that the observations are to be covered by this prediction 90% of the times. So what we do in practice, we just take a frequencies approach and we just simply count the number of times where the observation was above or lower. And by simply counting, you can verify if you have respect your probability contract. So this is named probabilistic calibration. So to do that, you make your count, and then you can summarize this count into reliability diagram. So here, for instance, the model has predicted several quantile forecasts with different nominal levels. So 5%, 10%, 15%, 20%, etc., etc., up to 95%. So you have 20 different quantile forecasts. And for each one of them, they have count the number of times the true realization was above or lower the quantile. And so to just verify with graphical representations, you put on this plot your count and you compare it to an ideal situation. And so quantile forecasts are evaluated one by one, and the empirical levels are reported versus the nominal level. And the closest to the diagonal, the better is your model. So here, for instance, we can see that for this model, it is not so bad because most of the time, it is very, very close to the diagonal, except for the first quantile, because here we can see that for the first quantiles, it is a little bit lower, but then it is okay. So you just count. So for a quantile, for instance, 10%, you will have a look at your forecast and you count the number of times the observation was really above and was really below 10%. And if 90% of the time you are above, it's okay. Now the sharpness. So the sharpness of probabilistic forecasting is about the concentration of probability. A perfect probabilistic forecast gives a probability of 100% on a single value, but it is perfect probability. And of course, we do not have in practice perfect probability. Consequently, a sharpness assessment boils down to evaluating how tight the predictive densities are. So for instance, let's consider a prediction interval. So this prediction interval is composed, for instance, by two quantiles. So we could consider an 80% prediction interval that is composed of the quantile 90% and the quantile 10%. So in on average, we would expect 80% of the value of the observed value that would rely within this interval. Then you can so compute the width of this interval, that is just the upper extreme quantile minus the lower extreme quantile. And so you compute what is it in reality, and you make the average over your validation set. So let's have a look at it. So here, for instance, the nominal quantiles are 10%, 20%, 90%. So you have these quantiles, so nine quantiles, and they computed the width for each interval. And so let's take, for instance, the prediction, the width of 90%, and see how it looks like regarding the lead time. So the lead time is also the forecasting horizon. So here it is expressed in hour. So 48 hours means 2 days. So it is a forecast in 2 days. So here the forecasts are from 1 hour up to 2 days. And here we can see that the interval width increases with the lead time. That in fact reflects higher forecast uncertainty. And in a sense, it seems okay because, of course, the more you want to forecast into the future, the more difficult it will be. So the more you will have some uncertainty. So this shape looks okay, in a sense. And you can see that the width increases very, very rapidly with the forecasting horizon. So it means that the forecast uncertainty has increased mostly in the first hours. But because, for instance, if you consider PV generations, your weather forecast may be very accurate in a few hours, because in a few hours you will be able to predict when you will have some clouds or on the sun, etc. But in 1 day, it's very, very difficult to be able to predict when you will have some clouds. It is very difficult to forecast cloud. That's why most of the time the forecast uncertainty is increasing a lot within the first few hours. Then we have the overall skill assessment. So the skill of a probabilistic forecast can be assessed by some scores, like the mean absolute error, but mean absolute error is for point forecasting. You cannot use the mean absolute error for computing some score on a probabilistic forecast. How can you do that? So that's why you have different kind of metric score for probabilistic forecasting. And one of the most common skill score for predictive densities or quantiles is a continuous rank probability score. And in fact, it is a kind of extension of the mean absolute error for point forecast. But that is for probabilistic forecasting. So you have here the definition, and you can compute. This score is quite nice because it allows to compare point forecast and a probability forecast, because the CRPS and the mean absolute error can be directly compared. So let's take an example. So let's come back to our case study. That is the University Liège PV parking rooftops. Here we have three models. In blue, feed-forward neural network. In red, recurrent neural network, that is a long short-term memory. And in green, we have a gradient boosting regression model. And so we computed quantile forecast for PV generations on this data set by using an 11 cross validation. So K cross validation, but here K is equal to 11. So we computed 11 pairs of random learning and validation set. And we computed the CRP split time for each one of these 11 validation set from the K cross validation. And then, based on this 11 CRP split time, we computed the average. And we did that for the three forecasting model, okay? So this is how we have this plot. And so on this plot, you have for each lead time, the average CRPS. And you can have a look at it. And it seems that the red model, the long short-term memory, provides the best results in terms of CRPS because most of the time, for most of the lead times, it is smaller than the gradient boosting regressor in green and the feed-forward neural network in blue. But it is just a score. So it means, okay, maybe this model, the red one, is better in terms of CRPS, but maybe for another matrix, it will not be better than this model. This model is good for just this matrix. So a metric is not an end in itself. It is just an indicator. So you can have a nice result for this metric, but it does not mean that your forecast is good. It just means that it is good for this metric. So that's why most of the time we combine several metrics or several ways of assessing the forecast because we cannot just rely on one metric. But it is always the same thing. It depends on the application of the forecast. It depends on what you want to do with the forecast. It depends on the decision making. So you use metrics or way of assessing your forecast regarding an application, regarding what you want to do with your forecast, because you want to select the best model, the best forecasting techniques regarding your application. And so maybe for a specific application, so let's imagine, for instance, we would like to use PV forecast, PV quantile forecast for decision making for a microgrid to bid on the market because we would like to make money by bidding optimally the PV generation of our microgrid on the market. So for this application, maybe we will use a CRPS, but maybe then we will use the same microgrid, so the same PV generation, but the application will not be to bid on the market. Maybe it will be to maximize the self-consumption of the microgrid. So we are not interested anymore in making money in the market, but we are interested in maximizing self-consumption. So maybe we will use another metric to assess the forecast to help the decision-making to maximize self-consumption. So it completely depends on your applications. And so when you are doing forecasting, one of the first questions that you have to raise is, first, what is my application? Of course, so it will define your forecasting problem because depending on your application, you will be able to define what will be the kind of forecast you want. Is it, do you need point forecast? Do you need probability forecast? Depending on your application. Then once you made your choice, you will find a model, the most reliable or suitable model depending on your application. And so you will use metrics related to your application. So that's why I think if you have to keep in mind something after these two lessons about forecasting. So the first one was an introduction to point forecasting, and this one was an introduction to probability forecasting. It is that forecasting is a natural step to decision making. But so you do forecast for something. You do not do forecast just for itself. So your application, your forecasting problem, it is what will design your forecasting model. So for microgrid, you have several key parameters, generation, load prices, and depending on what are these key parameters, you will build a forecasting model. In terms of probabilistic forecasting, we have seen that there are several kinds of techniques. There is a quantile forecasting, the density forecast, the prediction interval, and the scenario. There are four different forecasting techniques for doing probabilistic forecasting. And so they do not produce the same output. So in fact, it does, they, these are techniques that will provide you some information. And depending on your application, you may be interested in using one technique, for instance, quantity forecasting, or maybe scenario. It depends on what you want to do with your forecast. So it depends on what is your decision making, because they do not provide the same information, but they are all estimates of the random process, but the output is different. Then, once you have selected the kind of probabilistic forecasting you want to use, so for instance, quantity forecast, you may want to ask you, what do you want to do with your forecast? How do you want your forecast? It is depending on your application. Do you want your forecast to be reliable? Do you want your forecast to be sharp? Do you want to be your forecast to be skilled regarding to a specific score? So then, depending on what you want to do with your forecast, you will select some metrics depending on what you want to do with it. And then you will have to adopt a strategy to assess your forecast. So there are several strategies. So here we have seen two. The first one that is quite basic is to take your data set, to split the data set into a learning and a validation set. You train your model on the learning part, you estimate your parameters of your model, and then you use the validation data that has not been used by the model to learn the parameter to compute your score. The K cross validation, it is the same thing. It is completely the same thing, but you compute K pairs of random learning and validation set. But in essence, it is the same kind of validation methodology. If you want to dip further, there are some here, there are some references. So there are some online lessons from Pierre Persson, that is someone quite famous in the forecasting field. And I based most of these slides of these two lessons on online lessons. And there is also a free online chapter at this link. So thank you for your attentions, and I will answer to your questions during a Q&A session. Thank you.